And good evening, everyone. And at the outset, I would like to thank you all for taking our time after a long day at work. And also, I'm honored to be presenting in front of like-minded people from the BA chapter. And as Swami said, that I am a total technology person. So just nice that you had the finance side first, and now we move over to technology, right? So what's interesting about finance is that all of us are sitting on ocean of data. And it's not just that. The International Data Corporation actually has it out there that in the next 5 years, there's going to be almost 170 zettabytes of data worldwide, which is 10 times the volume that we have as of today. What does that mean to us? This means that we need to reevaluate how we consider and treat our data assets. And this is pushing companies to reevaluate their analytics platforms and have a full-scale analytics adoption. Which brings me to my session for today, which is to talk about new trends in the analytics market, and specifically about augmented analytics, which is the new wave in this industry. So moving on. So to start with, what really is augmented analytics, right? So a couple of years ago, Gartner, which is the leading market research company in the world, coined this term called augmented analytics, which was then claimed to be the next future in analytics space. Let's see what they have to say about this. I'm going to take a pause and let you guys read what this really what they said about this. Now, while this is a great definition for data experts, it's not detailed enough for most of us to understand what augmented analytics really is. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take a step back to see how it all started. It all started somewhere like this. This is typically how people used to access data in the beginning of the years, and this has vastly changed in the last 3 decades. Most of us are somewhere here today. We all have some access to portals or applications wherein we can go in and have access to our data at the tip of our fingers, right? How did we reach here? The first wave of analytics was in the 1990s, as a result of which we got platforms that were able to answer the what and the how of our business in that moment of time. So maybe it could tell you information like your revenue is decreasing by 10% as compared to last month, or other scorecards or KPI-based, very statistical, static reporting. What happened after that is there was another shift in space, and people wanted to move away from the static information to a new era that was for self-service analytics, or as I like to call it, the so what of analytics. Going back to the example of declining revenue, so now that I know that my revenue is declining by 10%, what does that mean to me for my business? Is this something that's an industry trend? Is it something that's because of, let's say, a new advertising channel that I introduced that didn't work? Or is it some other reason? So as people got more and more inquisitive, they wanted answers which they did to questions which they didn't even think of, and they were changing every day. So how do we give them the capability to do that every day without having to rely on static information? That's where the self-service era came in. And it started at the beginning of this decade. But here's the thing. To be able to get that instant answer to your questions, it's not as easy. Not only do you have to have access to the right information, the right data from your sources, you make sure that the information is consumable. You conduct analysis on it, you generate insights, you try to share it within your organization to finally come up with a plan of action. And here's what we realized, that this era, it opened our eyes to a new set of challenges and actually paved path for a new wave that we are now in. Now, while most of us are here, I'm going to spend a little bit more time to understand what were the challenges that we really faced in this era. To put it very crudely, The business that we are all in, the processes associated with it, they are not simple. The data underlying all the organization, it's not simple. And most importantly, not everyone is a data expert. So statistically speaking, there's just 1.5 million data experts worldwide who's actually working to support about 1.2 billion people every day. And what happens as a result of this unfair ratio is that there is a constant struggle between these two group of people for, you know, one asking for something and the other asking back for some information. So there's typically an average of over 5 days that people take to respond to a new data request. What happens as a result of this is that people don't have access to right information at the right time. And most of the times, they're not even aware that there is some data that exists in the company that they could take advantage of before making a decision, or even how to use the data that's available to them. And at the end of the second wave, these are some of the statistics that tell us about the gravity of this situation. And even for organizations that have been around for many years, and organizations at all scale, they still fail to incorporate data-based decision-making into their daily business processes. And as a consequence of that, most of their decisions are based on uninformed data. So this brings me back to a simpler problem statement for us that was at the end of the second era. How do we make this information more easily accessible for everyone? And that's the stage that we are today. And that brings us to augmented analytics. Analytics is no longer about adoption, about who has access. It's now more about how easy is it for a general workforce to consume information, to take action on information, and imbibe it into their daily decision-making processes. And coming back to the question that we started with, what really is augmented analytics? I'm going to answer this question in two parts. Firstly, it's the ability to increase human understanding of data by automating insight generation. And secondly, it's the ability to democratize analytics so that it's accessible by all people in all forms and in all senses. How do platforms work for this, right? So I'm going to start with the most common, as of today, possibly to get information from another person. The most common way that we have is the messaging service, right? So what we do is we can take advantage of the same thing and run live chatbots for analytics on our data. And just like people have conversations amongst each other, they can actually have conversations with the data. And this is a video wherein a person is interacting with data as it would with a normal person. And because of continuity and consistent conversation and this personalized remembering, the person can actually talk in a very conversational manner, and it's not just very static information. And moreover, what you can also do is that understand how the technology has advanced to support conversational analytics. This is actually defined as a human having a conversation with the system about data. And not only is the system able to leverage context to understand user content, the way it responds is so natural that the person doesn't feel like it's talking to a bot. And that's how it increases their level of adoption and comfort for coming back to these platforms. Another way is to leverage natural language by leveraging the sense of sight to consume and generate information that may sometimes be overlooked by the human eye. And natural language is probably the best way to bring technology to a much broader audience. How is that? Well, if we take a look at this dashboard, it's a very simple dashboard, but what happens nowadays is that not everyone is data literate. And sometimes information gets lost even in visualizations. How do we ensure that people who are not data literate can still consume analytics without having to struggle too much with the knowledge curve? So you can easily convert information and visualizations into narratives which are very insightful and that can be used and acted upon by just anyone. So now that I have an easy to understand narrative, I can simply read through and understand what that chart was trying to tell me in the first place. Another thing that greatly improves adoption is having the ability to have query-based analytics platform. Not only is a person in this case not restricted by analytics or their software skill sets, the only thing that's holding them back to start with their analytics journey is the breadth of questions that they can hold. They can have a relational keyword search or a search in terms of natural language. Based on the question they ask, the system actually generates the most appropriate chart, which can further be enhanced to suit the person's choice. And not only that, based on your past questions and what the others in your user group are asking, you actually get recommendations to ask similar questions. And because the platform is so easy to use, sophisticated analytics workers can actually define dashboards which can be very quickly built and shared to a larger audience. So this is actually not a fast forward, and this was something I was doing at that time, and it took me less than 1 minute to build this. That's how easy this system is to actually start using. Now, while all of these approaches that I just spoke about, they're very good to increase adoption of analytics or even have easy access to data. But the biggest assumption in all of these is that the people involved are looking for data. What about people who don't know that this data exists? Or they don't know that there is data out there in the organization which they can readily use to make better decisions every day? That is the kind of population that's actually 70% of the workforce. To achieve true data democratization, that's the target audience that we also have to reach out to. How do we do that? Is by introducing a way to proactively push information to them in their regular workflows. Let's say if they are receiving emails or if they are working on, let's say, a browser to search for anything. If they have information that is proactively pushed out to them, that's the reason why it's zero click. It's not one click, two click. It automatically pushes out to you the moment it's available, and it can be made available not just in your business workflows, but on any application that you use every day. So it's imbibed in your everyday workflow, so you don't have to leave out to get that information. This is the only way that we can reach the workforce that's not looking for information, by pushing out very easy to read cards that are not just easy to read, but also are personalized based on your role, based on your function in the organization, which ensures that not only people have access to the right data at the right time, but they have access to the right data at all times. Whenever they are using anything, they have access to information to make better decisions. Moving on, the last bit of sense is the sense of sound and speech. So voice-enabled assistants are something that are rapidly changing and emerging in the market. With a quick show of hands, how many in this room have never used a voice assistant? Be it Siri, Google, Alexa, any of these. Almost everyone has. And with the kind of technology that's coming up, so Google recently raised the curtain on Google Duplex, which was a voice assistant that was intelligent enough to have a phone call and book an appointment for you with a hairdresser. And in no way, if I was told that this is not voice assistant, would I be able to tell it's not an actual person? That's how we have come with technology. So why don't we have this as another medium to get information out of the systems, get information out of the lake of data that we have? So voice assistants is another way that we can leverage and tap onto existing data systems to get access to information. And one such use case is to use voice commands to get data out of amplified smart screens.
Show me my west region. Show me my northeast region.
While there are many technologies out that can play with the data. What I would like to spend some time on now is talk about three use cases in particular that actually took advantage of some of the technologies that I just spoke about, and how did it affect their internal processes. The first one that I want to talk about is about a multinational bank. So they realized that they have a lot of these business customers which could take advantage of all the data that they have. So they decided to monetize their data by selling their insights. And when they started out, it wasn't very well received, because to be able to use those insights, there is a little, you know, learning curve. What they did is they replaced that platform totally with a search chat-based platform, wherein the as a user, I can go in, I can have questions about how my sales are up to date, or I could ask questions about how I can optimize my cash flow, or understand as a peer-to-peer benchmark where I stand within the industry. And because of the nature of this application, which was conversational analytics, which had negligible learning curve, they were able to release this to more than 500,000 customers, and they were able to monetize this information within 2 years. The next one that I want to talk about is about a financial services company, which was actually sitting on a huge data lake without really taking advantage of any data to optimize their business processes. All of their data requests were very IT-driven. For every request, they went back to IT, and they found it very hard to move beyond the static, regulatory, or monthly reports. So as a last resort, the company decided to invest in a search-based platform wherein the users could, in their natural language, ask questions and tap into the analytics systems to get answers for any known or unknown questions that the people may have, right? And given an option to search for questions by themselves or rely on IT to provide information, they had a clear winner. And even though it started, it was released on a very small scale. In a couple of months, this thing picked up like growth exponentially, and they actually have a huge user base which is now using this, and their IT is now investing more time in growing this platform rather than handing out user requests as they were doing before. The third one is another very interesting use case about an e-payment services company. So this company had a huge influx of calls that the customers used to make after their payments, some inquiries, or my payment failed, and what went wrong, and what happened. And their biggest challenge was that they had to get the customer details, information about any open cases or past interactions ready with them before their greeting got over. And if you don't have a system that can answer questions like that, it's very hard to be able to ready by the time you say, okay, hello, how are you doing today, right? And what happens is that if you put those calls on hold, and I'm sure we all hate being put on hold on those call center helplines, they either need to change the music or do something like this, right? So what these guys decided to do is to introduce zero-click intelligence for their call center executives, wherein by the time they received the call, they had dedicated information windows that came up about their customer, about open cases, and all past interactions. A wide spectrum of information that they could use to address that call and make that experience much better. And even though it's some recent deployment, they have been able to significantly see an improvement. There's a drastic drop in the call waiting time, as a result of which there was a great improvement in their productivity and customer satisfaction rate. Now, before I wind up, I want to take a minute to talk about why these customers were able to successfully deploy these solutions. So even though these are newer technologies, the reason why these customers were successfully able to deploy is that because they didn't look for a purpose-built solution or a purpose-built tool to do this. The technology is going to change so often that if you have to find a tool for every new thing that comes out there, you're going to be maintaining a stack which is sooner or later going to be out of your control. What they did is that you could be having any spectrum of analytics or technology that takes the market today. What's important is to have a central layer that makes it transparent to the business. you could be adding anything on the top, or you could be adding any new data source at the bottom. The only reason why they could do it is because they were using a platform called MicroStrategy, which is the only platform which has been able to survive not just the first wave, the second wave, but it's also ready to take on the third wave or anything that comes after that. With that, I would like to close my session and invite our host back. Thank you.